Hello and welcome to this brief overview of using Dialogue Manager 3 in Godot. In this video, I'm going to cover a bunch of stuff that you might need to know to get going with dialogue in your game. Dialogue Manager is extremely versatile, so I won't be able to cover absolutely everything, but I will be talking about a lot of stuff, so let's get started. First up, what is Dialogue Manager? Dialogue Manager is a stateless and headless system for handling non-linear dialogue flow within a Godot game. So there's three things there to talk about. One, stateless. That means Dialogue Manager keeps no state of its own and keeps your game as the authority on all state. You don't have to fiddle with passing variables through any middleware or whatever. Two, headless. Dialogue Manager comes with an example dialogue balloon, but it's just that, an example. Think of the Dialogue Manager runtime as a data provider. The idea is that you make your own dialogue balloon that better suits the specific look and feel of your game, and then use Dialogue Manager to provide the dialogue information. In fact, for most of this video, I'll be using the custom balloons that I've made for my game, Bravest Coconut, which lists on Steam. And three, non-linear. Dialogue Manager provides a bunch of control flow constructs that let you easily build multiple paths through your dialogue. I'll go into more detail on that point as we progress through this video. Okay, let's install Dialogue Manager. You can do it from the asset library, from GitHub, or from itch.io. I'll do it from the asset library. You can see here that there is a Dialogue Manager 2 and Dialogue Manager 3. You can use Dialogue Manager 2 if you're stuck on a version of Godot from 4.3 down. Dialogue Manager 3 is for Godot 4.3 and up, so that's what I'll be using here. Once it's installed, go and enable it in Project Settings. Now you'll see this Dialogue tab at the top of the editor. From here, we can create a new dialogue file. The most basic dialogue is just a character name followed by a colon and then some text that the character is saying. So here we can see the character Nathan is saying, "Hi, I'm Nathan." And then we have another character, Coco, saying, "Hi Nathan, I'm Coco." If I press the test from the start of the file button here, we can bring this up in the example balloon and see it in action. And just to reiterate, this example balloon is meant just as a baseline for you to build your own balloon. I'll be showing any further dialogue as it would appear using my custom balloon from Bravest Coconut. So this is what that same dialogue would look like in that. Now, if you want to add some personality to the text, you can use BB Code. For example, let's add a wave. We'll make Coco say she loves pizza and emphasize the loves. That looks like this. BB code like wave and shake are built into Godot's rich text label, but there's also a few other codes supplied by Dialogue Manager. If you want to add a quick pause midline, then you can add a wait like this. That will add a 1 second pause at that point in typing out the line. You can change the number value to change the time to wait. You can also change the speed of typing with a speed code. The number you give is a multiple of the default speed, so here 0.2 means that it will type at 1/5 of the default speed, like this. Now, let's add some interactivity to the dialogue. We can do that by specifying a list of possible responses. Response lines begin with a hyphen, like this. Responses will generally be presented as a list for the player to choose from. Just for a quick reference, this is what they look like in the example balloon. And this is what they look like in Bravest Coconut. Okay, now responses aren't much use if choosing one doesn't do anything, so let's see how we can add actual branching. There are two ways we can do that. The first way is to indent some more dialogue below each response, like this. So now, when we pick a response, the nested dialogue plays out and then dialogue flow returns to the point just after the responses were presented. The other way to branch off is to use a go-to line. Go-to lines, or jump lines as some people call them, are written with an equals followed by a greater than symbol and then the name of a title to jump to. Titles are kind of like named markers in dialogue that we can refer to. Those lines start with a tilde, like this. So we can add a title in at the top here called Start. Then we can have a response that says Start Again and add a go-to reference to jump back to that Start title. Now, when we pick that response, the flow of dialogue will jump back to the start. You can have as many titles as you need in order to jump around your dialogue. Another kind of go-to line is one that jumps to a title and follows the flow there before returning back to the jump line and continuing back here. To write one of those, you start the line with an equals, followed by a greater than, and then a less than. The idea here is that you can reuse chunks of dialogue in a few places, so the jump line is effectively just inserting that chunk whenever you need to use it. To end a block of dialogue, you can use a special go-to reference to end in all capitals. This means end this block, and if flow needs to return somewhere, then return there. To force the end of a conversation and ignore any returns, then you can use a go-to reference to end in all capitals followed by an exclamation point. So let's test out a small snippet. I can write a separate block with just a couple of lines and then end it. Then, in the main flow, I can write a go-to and return statement, and that works something like this. When writing dialogue, it's important to know when something is wrong. While it isn't always possible to detect errors at the time of writing code, Dialogue Manager will do what it can to try and spot stuff as you're writing it. For example, if I misspelled the title reference in this go-to line, it would tell me that there is no title called that. And keep in mind, when there are known errors in a file, Dialogue Manager won't be able to run that file to show dialogue in your game. Okay, so how do we show dialogue in a game? As I mentioned before, Dialogue Manager is meant to be headless and is only really responsible providing data to your dialogue balloon, not the balloon itself. That said, the built-in example balloon will suffice if you're in a hurry or you don't care that it probably doesn't suit the look of your game. When you do get to the stage of making your own balloon, you can use the example balloon as a starting point. There is a command in the Project Tools menu for creating a clone of the example balloon into your project. From there, you'll mostly just need some knowledge of how Godot's control nodes work. Dialogue Manager provides a dialogue label control for typing out dialogue and a responses menu control for handling player choices, but apart from that, it's all just regular Godot nodes for everything. I recommend just having a read through the Godot documentation on control nodes. That's all I did to make the balloon for Braver's Coconut. If you do need a bit of help with some of the more common balloon implementations, then I do have a few example projects available on my itch page. Links to them in the description. Once you have your balloon ready, you probably want it to appear in your game, and to do that, you have a couple of options. The first one is to use the built-in showDialogBalloon method. This works for a lot of game setups, but does make a few assumptions that won't necessarily work for everyone. If that's you, then your second option is to code a custom method that shows your balloon. Basically, all it needs to do is instantiate your balloon and then start the dialogue chain with a given dialogue resource. Now that we have a way of showing our dialogue, we can get back to writing it. The next thing you might want to do is branch your dialogue based on some value of game state. For example, you might want a character to say something different the first time they are met. For that, you might want to write something like this. But what is game state and has met Nathan? In this example, game state is an autoload and has met Nathan is a Boolean property of it. By default, Dialogue Manager has access to all autoloads. To modify state, we can write what's called a mutation line. This one is pretty simple. Set has met Nathan equals true. This does what you'd expect, so the next time we talk to Nathan, the dialogue goes down the other path. While we're talking about state, let's have a look at where Dialogue Manager looks for state. First, it will look in any nodes passed to extra game states, which is the third parameter in the showDialogBalloon method that we talked about earlier. Then, it will check in the current scene. Now, what current scene means will depend on how your game is structured. If you have a scene manager, you'll probably want to override getCurrentScene when your game boots to tell Dialogue Manager how to resolve the current scene. If you aren't using a scene manager, then it will automatically use what Godot thinks is the current scene. And lastly, it will check any autoloads. In the has met Nathan example earlier, we used an autoload, but what about referring to something in the current scene? In this scene, I have a method that plays an animation. If I start dialogue within this scene, then my dialogue script can refer to that method directly. We do this using a mutation line, do play animation. But this doesn't wait for the animation before continuing the dialogue. In order to wait for the animation to finish, we need to await the animation player's animation finish signal within the mutation. Dialogue Manager automatically waits for async methods. If you do intentionally want to not wait, even if the method is async, then you can add an exclamation point to the do. This tells Dialogue Manager to continue with dialogue immediately. Before, we looked at if conditions, but Dialogue Manager also supports while and match conditions too. While statements work similarly to if statements, except that we continually loop over the body of the while block until its condition is false. In this example, we loop through the whole block until the value is 5 before continuing. Match statements are kind of a shortcut that replaces multiple if statements that would all be checking the same condition. So instead of writing something like this with a bunch of ifs, you could write it with a match. Match lines take the form of the word match and then a variable or expression. Then each possible branch starts with an indented when line that includes the value to match against. So if the match variable matches 5, then the when 5 branch will be chosen to follow. Let's talk more about expressions. So far, I've mentioned that expressions can be used in conditions and mutations, but they can also be used in dialogue in both the character name and the spoken text. To insert the value of an expression, wrap it in double curlies. This will resolve the expression at runtime and include the value into the line. Expressions in character names work in a similar way. If you've let your player provide a name for a character, then you can use that name by specifying the variable within double curlies. You can also use expressions as part of inline conditions. Depending on where you use inline conditions will change a little about what they actually do. If you use one inside a response, like this, then this response will need to pass that condition check before it is allowed to be selected by the player. If you use an inline condition within some dialogue, you can optionally show a part of it if that condition is met. Make sure to include a closing slash if tag here too. Responses don't need a closing tag because the whole line is part of the condition, whereas with dialogue, only the text between the tags is included in the condition. You can also use expressions as inline mutations. If you want something to happen during a line of dialogue, then you can wrap the usual do syntax of a mutation in square brackets and place it within the dialogue text. For example, I want this owl to flap its wings mid-sentence here, so I add an inline mutation to do it. And just so you know, I can refer to owl here in dialogue because it is defined in the current scene. And one last place for expressions that I'll mention is jumps. If you use an expression as the jump target, then the resolve value of that expression will be assumed to be a title and the flow of dialogue will jump to that title. Be careful with expression jumps because the dialogue compiler can't check for valid titles at compile time. Now let's talk about adding some randomness. If you have a few variations of the same line that you want to randomly choose between, then you can prefix those lines with a percent symbol. These three lines will have an equal chance of being selected. If you want to give a line more weighting in the randomized selection, then you can add a number to the percent sign. The first line is now 5 times more likely than the others to be chosen. Percent symbols can be used on whole blocks of dialogue as well. To have a series of lines be counted towards the same random outcome, then indent those lines below the percent symbol line, like this. Groups of random lines are separated by an empty line. Dialogue lines can have a series of tags attached to them. To specify tags, write them within square brackets and beginning with a hash symbol. At runtime, these tags will be available as the tags property of the given dialogue line. You can use an equal sign within a tag to specify values against keys. To extract the value at runtime, you can use getTagValue on the dialogue line and then provide the key. You can import dialogue from one file into another file. Say you have some common snippets of dialogue that are shared with a number of dialogue files. Instead of copy-pasting them into each file, you can import them like this. This snippet file has a tell joke title, so when I import it into this file, I have access to that title through the import alias snippets. The alias for an imported file can be whatever you like, as long as it doesn't include spaces or symbols other than underscores. When it comes to localizing your dialogue, you have a couple of options. Dialogue Manager supports both CSV and GetText varieties of translation. To export lines to CSV, click Translations and then Save Lines to CSV. This will export all of the translatable lines in this file out to the target CSV file. If the file already exists, it will attempt to merge any lines into the file. If you are utilizing voice acting, you might want to make use of static line IDs for your dialogue. You can either write them manually as square bracket, capital ID, colon, and then an ID string, or you can go to the translations menu and choose Generate Line IDs and have Dialogue Manager attempt to generate them for you. It will do its best to make unique IDs, but it can't 100% guarantee uniqueness across multiple files. When exporting dialogue to CSV, if the line IDs are present, then they will be used as the translation key in the CSV file. Once you have the translation CSV file, then localization is handed over to Godot itself to manage. The other option for translation, and my personal preference, is to use Godot's built-in POT file generation. Dialogue files automatically get added to the list of translatable contents when you tell Godot to generate the POT file. It will include any dialogue in your project. The reason I prefer this is because it includes every translatable string in the whole project, not just dialogue, as a single file in one go. The caveat here is that line IDs aren't used as translation keys in the resultant POT file. Instead, they're used as POT context. You can still use the IDs for voice acting keys, though. No matter which method you use for translation, Dialogue Manager will work pretty much the same way. Every translatable line gets run through Godot's translation method, so if a translation is known to Godot, then it will be included in Dialogue. And that wraps up all the stuff that you need to be aware of for now. If you need some help with your Dialogue, then you have a few avenues to explore. I have a few example projects available on my itch.io page, which I'll link to in the description. This one demonstrates a custom balloon that has portraits and uses tags for emotion changes. This one demonstrates voice acting and translations, including localized voice acting. And this one demonstrates infinite scroll type dialogue and asking the player for text input. You can also jump into my Discord, where me or one of the other knowledgeable Dialogue Manager users can probably answer your question. And if you'd like to support the development of Dialogue Manager as well as get access to a bunch of handy code snippets, then you should become a patron today. A big shout out to this month's Cockatoo patrons, Mark Lucia and Vanillib. And this month's Owl patron, Mario J. Roberti. And that's all from me for now. Bye.